Welcome back. Let me show you a great example of Trump's fixation with cable news and his use of Twitter to react. Tonight, the New York Times debuts its first ever Oscars ad. Take a look here. It's all about the truth and with the aim of signing you up as a subscriber to the Times. Now, I talked about this ad on CNN at 6:34 a.m. this morning with CNN's Victor Blackwell on New Day. Exactly 8 minutes later, the president tweeted this, calling out the failing New York Times for running the ad. What do you think? A coincidence? Or was he watching CNN? You decide. The Times has been one of the president's favorite targets. In fact, he's tweeted about the NYT, labeling it failing 53 times, clearly trying to get that nickname to stick. So joining me now is the head of that newsroom, Dean Baquet, the executive editor of the New York Times. And let's clear it up right away, Dean. Is the Times failing? Why does he say it? What are the facts?
We're not failing at all. In fact, our digital subscriptions are going through the roof. Even print subscriptions are up. We're a profitable company. We're a newsroom that's hiring. I mean, we're a big, vibrant, important newsroom. I think the reason he goes after us, to be frank, is I think there is an effort by this administration to minimize the press. I think that their goal, it's just evident, is to make it so there are a handful of independent institutions whose job it is, and we're among them, to critique the president, to hold the president accountable. The judiciary is in the same batch. And I think if you look at the pattern of the president's tweets, they're actually designed to minimize the institutions who are charged with holding him accountable. And I think that's dangerous.
Do you think these are authoritarian tendencies, the way some outsiders have suggested they are?
I'm not going to go that far. I'm going to hold on to my newsroom hat of not characterizing things that way. But I think it's troublesome. I think it's dangerous. I think it means that all of the institutions, including the press and particularly the New York Times, whose job it is to ask hard questions, if he continues doing what he's doing, he's attempting to make that harder to do. It will not be harder to do inside our newsrooms. We're going to ask hard questions. We're going to continue to be tough analysts and reporters about the Trump administration and its actions, fair and tough analysts. But I think he clearly wants to convince his supporters that we're not to be trusted.
And
he's wrong.
When he tweets about your company, does that help subscriptions? Is Trump the best thing to ever happen to the Times subscription strategy?
Trump is the best thing to happen to the Times subscription strategy. Yes, every time he tweets, it drives subscriptions wildly. He also, if I can say something, he's accomplished. I think that there was a long time when the press wondered about its place in the society. The last several years, as newspaper subscriptions sort of dwindled, as newspapers, particularly local newspapers, worried about their future. I think what's happened in the last couple months, I have to say, has been tremendous for news organizations. Huh. Our mission is clearer than it's ever been. We're covering a dramatic revolution in government and how the country is governed. And it feels like all of the things that sort of bothered us and made us lose a little bit of confidence in the last few months have sort of gone away. It is so clear what our mission is.
Now, I think a lot of Trump supporters would hear you say that and say, why weren't you doing that for 8 years when President Obama was in office? Why have you all suddenly discovered your mission?
Well, I think that those supporters were not reading the New York Times. I mean, I keep using the example of Tom Daschle. And Tom Daschle, in the beginning of the Obama administration, Tom Daschle was the most powerful person emerging in the Obama administration. There was relentless coverage of him by the New York Times, the Washington Post, and others about the fact that he still had a lobbying business. And eventually, Tom Daschle had to leave the Obama administration. We've been tough on all presidents. This is not a new phenomenon. The new phenomenon is maybe we have a president who doesn't understand that that's our role.
Let's look at something he said at CPAC on Friday. The president was talking about anonymous sourcing. So if we can cue this up in the control room, this is what the president said about the use of sources.
They just make them up when there are none. I saw one story recently where they said 9 people have confirmed. And I said, give me a break, because I know the people. I know who they talk to. There were no 9 people.
Tell us, Dean, how anonymous sourcing actually works at the Times.
First, I should point out that if you read the history of Donald Trump and his dealings with the press, including a story we published today, he's been an anonymous source. He's been an anonymous source throughout his career, especially when it helped him and when it burnished his reputation.
True.
Look, when you cover national security, when you cover the areas that we're working on, people cannot attach their names to them. Some of the most important stories of a generation, whether it's the New York Times' coverage of the NSA, whether it's Watergate, have come from anonymous sources. These are not people who pull us aside because they want to screw Donald Trump. These are people who are worried about the direction of government. These are people who are taking risks to talk to the media because they think these things need to be exposed. And I have to say, in an administration that has expressed so much distaste for the press and so much distaste for our role, are you surprised that some of the people who want to criticize the administration want to do it without their names attached? I'm not. And I think that you will see more use of anonymous sources. I think we have to be careful. I think it's got to be on the most important stories. But boy, are they important. We're in a different climate now.
I remember working at the Times years ago. The public editors would frequently weigh in and say, we've got to limit the use of anonymous sources. Readers don't know whether they can trust us. Is that a particular problem now as the Times and CNN and the Washington Post continue to break news about the Trump administration's various communications with Russia, but have to rely on anonymous sources?
I think what we have to do is be really careful. We have to make sure, I always know who the sources are for these stories. That's why I'm so confident pushing back at the Trump administration when they criticize the stories. I think we have to be really careful, but I think we have to own up to the fact that we're going to be in an era, as we have been before, where anonymous sources are going to be an important part of news coverage. And by the way, as long as the stories are accurate, as long as the stories are true, which so far has been the case, and as long as we offer the right perspective, I think that's fine.
So you've had no big stories where you've been led astray by these sources, where you've had to backtrack?
Nope. It has not happened in the Trump era. We have been every story. By the way, I should say, news organizations are flawed institutions. If we get something wrong, we correct it right away. And we own up to it. And as long as you do that, I think people will believe that you're honorable in your use of anonymous sources.
Dean, thank you very much for being here. Dean Baquet.
Happy to be here. Thanks.